ma'am, for such an interesting presentation and sharing your thoughts on this crucial aspect of waste management. I would now like to introduce our next speaker, Dr. Ramesh Kumar. Dr. Kumar is the Medical Officer of Health and Director of Public Health, Delhi Municipal Council. He has been working with NDMC for the past 20 years, and his area of expertise has been solid waste management. Dr. Ramesh will talk about the key issues in handling, treatment, and disposal of waste in COVID-19 scenario. Over to you, sir.
Thank you for inviting. In fact, I must thank Dr. Malini also. He informed me about this program. Thank you all the panelists. Me, Dr. Ramesh Kumar, basically I am looking after the municipal solid waste management. And if you talk about the any municipal body, it is basically the implementing agencies. And I feel sorry because we are very busy from the early in the morning to late night, I could not make any presentation. I will talk about all main headline on the handling, collection, treatment, and disposal of the COVID waste as well as solid waste management in NDMC area. I will talk about only the practical aspect, not the theoretical aspect, what we are doing and what we are implementing on ground at our own level. We don't require any help from anybody. We have very small compact area, 42.7 square kilometer area, having the fixed population about 2.76 lakh fixed population. No doubt we have a floating population about 15 to 20 lakh, but at a time, because most of all the offices and the market areas are closed. And as well as our Safai Kramchari is concerned, approximately about 2,000 Safai Kramchari we are having for our cleaning purpose. And as far as NDMC area, 50,000 household, we are catering the solid waste management facilities out there. In NDMC area, almost 100% door-to-door, we are carrying out by deployment of our auto tipper trucks, which are having the compartment for collection of dry and wet waste and a bag for collection of the domestic hazardous waste. No doubt segregation is a big challenge in all the municipalities, but as far as the NDMC is concerned, we have carried out on an average 85% segregation in NDMC area. But this is still a big challenge because it is a continuous process. We keep on motivating our household owners to give the segregated waste, but it is a continuous process. No doubt for that, we have involved all the Resident Welfare Association and Market Data Association to cooperate with us. For that, we have a regular interaction. Almost every fortnight, we keep on interacting. We are sending message. Or because of the corona, we are not interacting with them. But we are having some video conferences phone by telephonically. And as far as the solid waste management is concerned, approximately, I will concentrate basically on the COVID waste management, not the solid waste management. Everybody knows the solid waste management. But basically, because at present, main issue is the collection, treatment, disposal of the COVID waste. For the COVID waste in NDMC area, we have deployed dedicated one vehicle because we have not engaged the existing vehicle for who are collecting the solid waste collection. We have identified one dedicated vehicle for collection of the COVID-19 waste from identified households. This is a big challenge because we keep on training, keep on counseling the workers who are engaged for the COVID waste collection. Basically, they are initially very scared. Now we have trained them, we have provided all the protective equipment, we are continuously, in fact daily, we are motivating them. This is a noble cause. This, you are the real warrior, you are doing this practice. And in fact, we are carrying out the routine checkup every week about their checkup. But in the morning, we are taking their temperatures and the physical and the personalizing. Because personalizing is very important before the start of the work and after the start of the work. In fact, in NDMC area, about 35 to 40 households we are covering. We have one dedicated vehicle. A dedicated vehicle start early in the morning from 7:30. He goes all the households, 35 to 40 houses we have identified. We got the list from the DM office. Before the we got the list from the DM office, our resident welfare officials are so active and so proactive. They inform telephonically, this household comes positive. You start collecting the waste. in the vehicle we have this yellow double layer bag and black bag for collection of the COVID waste and the household waste. For the collection of the COVID waste, this identified vehicle, they collect, and after the collection they go to a one place where the authorized agency collect all the COVID waste, and we have got in NDM's area one isolation facilities at the Connaught Place area. From there, this all the COVID waste, and from the COVID waste of the households and the COVID waste of the isolation center go collected by the authorized agency and go to the common biomedical waste management facilities. No doubt, this I must appreciate the CPCB and DPCC to issue the do and don'ts, which are very helpful. We have distributed do and don'ts to all our resident welfare association and market aid association through their mobile or through the their email, so that they can aware. But still, this is a big challenge to collect the COVID waste from the household. Initially, the COVID waste they are just keeping on the roadside or throwing in the trolleys. We told this had to be collected from your household only. This is a continuous process that we are interacting with them. In fact, you talk about the challenges. Challenges is a daily continuous process. We keep on counseling to our Savai Kramcharis and the household waste collector Savai Kramchari, and we keep on training. And plus, one part is a vaccination. Vaccination is very important for these chaps, because they can have some or other medicine because of the common household. Because in India, people is very reluctant to do the segregation at household level. And another is that the personal hygiene of the our Savai Kramchari is very important. So we keep on telling, before you come to the duty, you should have a bath regular base, and after your duty, you should, before going to the school, before going to your house, you should clean your hand, foot and face on daily basis. And then they start telling from where we wash our hand, where they you dispose your facility, you dispose your waste. We have provided sanitizing facilities plus a separate washroom for the cleaning of the hand, face and feet. And challenges, it is a continuous process. Some or other challenges facing the household level, they are not sanitizing or not giving the waste in a proper way. That we keep on interacting with them. You have to do you have to give COVID waste. COVID waste is a face mask, gloves, or your spoiled article. No doubt in NDM's area, our public is very cooperative with us. They are helping in a lot. And this is a continuous process. Because time is very short, I have basically clicked very important aspect. I didn't go lot. I want to give you more details about the NDMC area, what NDMC is doing as far as the solid waste management is concerned. Because for the last 3 years, NDMC is getting first prize in the SWAS survey in 1 to 3 lakh population. But COVID waste is a big challenge. For that, we are regularly sending report to DPCC, and we have already sending the report on the app, what is it called, the waste tracking app. Daily we are sending the reports. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for sharing your thoughts and experiences. Moving on to the second segment of webinar, that is the panel discussion. I would like to invite Dr. Poonima to kindly come on board and moderate the session. During this session, we will be having a set of points that are key issues of concern around waste management. And during this, basically, we will call out on each topic, and this topic will be then shared with, it could be directed to individual speakers. So, Dr. Poonima, over to you. I will just take a moment to put up the slides.
Thank you, Ananya, and thank you to all the speakers for all those rich presentations. I think there was a lot of interest and queries also raised in the question and answer windows. But there are at least 5 to 6 key issues that we thought that would be important for you, the panelists, to address during this session. So may I now request, Ananya, are you sharing the questions? Yeah. Yeah, so I'd like to address this first question to Dr. Malini Kapoor, and I request all of you to keep it as brief as you can. We are already on the top of the hour, at the end of the hour that we had envisaged, but we can see that there is so much interest and so much of request for clarifying various aspects of waste management. So without further ado, Dr. Malini Kapoor, can I ask you to address this first question with regard to the safety of healthcare workers within the facilities, the COVID-19 hospitals? What are the challenges and what do we need to keep in mind regarding their safety? Dr. Kapoor? You have to unmute yourself, please.
Yeah. Am I audible?
Yes, now you are.
Thank you, Dr. Poonima. Like the challenges in the COVID-19 hospitals and the safety of healthcare workers, especially the challenges in the COVID-19 hospitals, I have already addressed in my PowerPoint. Like, you know, everything has now social distancing, whether it's biomedical waste management, and everything has hand hygiene training needs to be extensive, respiratory etiquettes, yawning and doffing. They need to be trained, all the healthcare workers. And the sanitation workers are at the lowest rung in this. And so whatever little we are doing, you know, everything is little. Whatever extensive we are doing means is little. I mean, we have to take their classes, social distance, by maintaining the social distancing norm, the barcoding, the biomedical waste management, and they have a scare for COVID-19, and every class we motivate them that you are the real COVID warrior and you have to really take this in your stride. And then we are also quarantining the staff, you know, after every 14 days we are giving them rest. We are posting them in the non-COVID zone also, after getting them posted in the COVID isolation wards or at the common waste site, then we are giving them lighter job. And then, you know, there is a CPCB app also, that is also, you know, that is an Android app that, some of the hospitals, they are mailing the CPCB for the data. And the biggest challenges from the common facility operator, like they're asking extra. Otherwise, if you compare the COVID biomedical waste and the non-COVID biomedical waste, and if you add them, you know, you'll find that whatever data we were getting in December and Jan, it is less. The biomedical waste quantum is not same as that what we were getting, because not many patients are visiting the hospital. It is mainly the COVID patients and the emergency patients or the delivery or the labor room patients who are visiting now. And our biggest challenge is not to mix biomedical waste with the municipal solid waste. That is the biggest challenge. And we have to take, you know, on-site classes also. And we know that it's a major public health concern. But we have to, at the time, we also have to make the public also aware of their social responsibility. So what we are doing is, in our classes only, we are training our healthcare workers so that they can train their other family members also how to dispose of masks and gloves. And as far as the safety of healthcare workers is concerned, this is of utmost importance, because, you know, especially the healthcare workers who are posted in the COVID zone, like the COVID isolation wards, ICUs, labs, or the SARI, severe acute respiratory ward, collection centers, they need to don full PPE. They have moderate to high risk. And as per the MOHFW guidelines and the WHO guidelines, they need to be trained on full PPE, donning and doffing and disposing of the PPE, and getting trained on the hand hygiene, respiratory etiquettes. And COVID-19 has given many messages that it's a major public health concern, and public health is an important subject, and healthcare investment is also crucial for all the government, all the countries. And whatever solution we are having now should be sustainable. And we also need to maintain the adequate and appropriate supply of PPE, whether we are posting our sanitation workers or doctors, nurses or technician in COVID or the non-COVID zone, by maintaining the rational use of PPE. And basically, we should be giving protection to all who are our healthcare workers, who are the main COVID warriors. And depending upon whether they are posted in the COVID zone or the non-COVID zone of the hospital. And that's it. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you so much. I think you touched upon very many pertinent points over there, from rotation of the healthcare professionals from COVID to non-COVID duties, the rational use of PPEs, and also the cascading of the training from through healthcare workers to their families, etc. Yes. I think they were very important points. Thank you for raising those and highlighting them. Address the next question to Dr. Ramesh Kumar. Were the issues around the safety of municipal waste and sanitation workers? You might have touched upon it, I think, a little bit, but if you want to elaborate a little bit more on how we address this.
Basically, if we talk about the safety of the municipal waste worker, it is a daily challenge. For that, we are carrying out counseling in the early morning, me and below me, my chief medical officer and inspected staff. They go early in the morning and keep counseling and keep interacting with our safai karmachari. We ask their problems, if they face any problem during work hour. Basically, we have to gain their confidence. Actually, we have to lead from the front. For that, we regularly interacting with our safai karmachari, and plus training part also. We train how to use protective equipment. Correct way protect equipment. For that, it is a daily routine. It is a daily routine we are doing, plus the hand hygiene, because they are cleaning the area, the public places. For public places, we have carried out anti-spacing law also. 1,000 rupees challan we have enforced. For that, we are carrying out a special team for enforcing this rule to the violator who are spitting on the public places. We are collecting 1,000 fines to them. No doubt, the public is also now very disciplined because of the COVID. They are very scared. So no doubt we have to implement then. Plus the social distancing. Dr. Malini is also social distancing, because in our safai karmachari, in the lunch hour, they keep sitting in a group. For that, we advise you keep maintain the social distance during their lunch hour and during their break, which we are keep on trying in the early stages also, during in the month of March, in the February, March also, because you have to maintain social distance during the working hours. Then this is a very key and very light issue, but is the most important issues. And during the early morning, we keep on asking, hey, are you okay? In your house, is anybody suffering from any problem for that? If a person said, in my family, one or other person is suffering fever, then we send our medical team to their household and check. So that this gave a boost, and this gave a moral support to our safai karmachari, we are with them. No doubt, we have a cashless facility for our safai karmacharis also. And next is the vaccination part, which is very important. That we are also taking care of that. On an average basis, after every six months, this is a annual feature. We are carrying out the medical examination of the safai karmachari. We know the data who are at the medical risk, who are chronic disease from diabetes and do the hypertension. For that, for them, we are giving very light duties. That we are taking care of our safai karmachari. Regarding the safety of the municipal waste, safety of the municipal waste, basically it is also a big challenge, because we have to deal with a public community, and it is a man management. Man management is very tough subject. For that, we have a good number of the household. They are interacting with whether if you want any help from resident welfare officer, they are helping us. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. I think that's a very important role that you play, you know, motivating the Safai Karmacharis. They are such a crucial part of our ecosystem, and keeping them motivated is really, really important. Thank you for that role that you embody. So can I request Ms. Ruth Stringer to address this next point on the role of educating the waste community about the use of PPEs in the right way?
Thank you, Dr. Purnima. Yes, of course I can. So I mentioned this a little bit before, but I think it's really important that people understand about PPE for waste workers. It's not the same as that for medical workers. Waste workers need it every day, and usually it's not disposable. So what they need is they need boots, strong gloves, depending on what they're doing. They may also need them to be heat protective or resistant to needle stick injuries. They need an overall or other uniform and a waterproof long sleeve apron or gown, and they need face protection. They don't need the FFP2, FFP3 or N95 masks that are being used by medical workers, because they are not being exposed to aerosols in the same way. But what they do need is protection against splashes and something that stops them touching their face. So they need face shields, goggles, and a surgical or cotton mask. Personally, I think that the face shields can be very good. And they're also particularly easy to clean. And one thing that's often overlooked is tongs. Nice long tongs like you'd have for a barbecue, so that if some waste is spilled, they don't have to pick it up with their hands. They should be minimizing handling of waste in any case. That's... Yeah, it should all be bagged, and you know, if it's not, they need to be protected from having to touch it in case there's something like glass that will pierce their gloves. They should be able to clean the PPE properly if they're going to reuse it. And of course, remember that, I mean, you know, only PPE that is designed for reuse should be reused. So PPE can be sponged down with soap first. This will remove dirt, which inactivates disinfectants, and it'll also destroy the coronavirus. Then it can be wiped down with disinfectant to remove other pathogens. And it can be either 70% alcohol or 0.1% hypochlorite, and that will depend on what's available, also what is appropriate for the equipment in question. Obviously, it's got to be compatible. Working clothes like uniforms or overalls should be provided by the employers and washed in the hospital laundry, not to be, you know, their own clothes to be taken home for their wives to wash by hand. And they should be washed at least 60 centigrade. And this maybe is another lesson that we learn about the proper development for hospitals from the virus, is that, you know, a lot of hospitals, at least in the places that I see, you know, and many of them outside India as well, is they don't have proper laundries. You know, stuff is being washed in cold water by hand. And this is where, you know, good investment can be made. As for municipal workers or anyone working in the informal thing, they should have a very similar sort of PPE. And it's far too often that they don't have it. But, you know, the question is about educating the waste handling community about the use of PPE. It's not just them that need to get the message. So often when I see people not wearing PPE, it's because they don't have it or it doesn't fit properly. And they know, you know, and people, you know, if it doesn't work for them, they won't wear it. This is not all to be put the burden on them. They may not understand the risks. There's research in Bangladesh saying that people actually believe, the waste workers actually believe, that because it comes from the hospital, it's going to be safe. they need to be properly educated about this. Or maybe they have so little trust in the system that they have a fatalistic attitude and that it's just down to their fate whether or not they're exposed. And again, it's up to the employers to make sure that they have that, you know, these things are dealt with. Workers dealing with waste need to be recognized as essential workers and provided with the educational, occupational health protection, pay and status that they deserve as a vital part of the environmental health and infection prevention and control. And this includes vaccination and post-exposure prophylaxis for existing diseases. And they should be prioritized along with health workers for coronavirus vaccination if and when becomes available. And then last little point, don't forget, as of yesterday, that WHO is advising everyone in the public to wear masks. So these can be cotton ones and, you know, should take them off without touching the mask itself. They can be stored for a few days in a paper bag and then ideally washed with plenty of soap before reuse. And to say that I think that all of our presentations are going to be shared. If you look at my presentation, you will see a link to some very good resources on how to put on and take off PPE properly that can be shared with your teams. Thank you.
Thank you, Ruth. I think that was very comprehensive and a good indication of how things should be addressed. I'm sure there are challenges in implementation, especially with the general waste managing community. But I think important for us to sit up and take notice and see how we can implement these on the ground. I request now Ms. Yuthika Puri to speak on this issue of the increasing quantities of yellow category waste, which is now overwhelming the incinerator capacity. Are there opportunities to explore alternate solutions?
Thanks, Dr. Poonima. Definitely there is an increase in yellow category of waste, which ideally shouldn't be happen, because if we see the scenario with the COVID positive patients, what all items which are actually related to the yellow category of biomedical waste come out of it. In our guidelines also, like, we have mentioned few items such as used mask and head cover, shoe cover, and other PPEs, disposable PPEs will go in yellow bags. Other than that, there is no anatomical waste, there is no as such body tissue, and since we don't have the exact vaccination for this COVID thing, we don't have enough like many numbers of syringes, etc. So there shouldn't be increase in specific yellow category of waste, but because of misunderstanding with respect to segregation of waste, everything is kept under the yellow colored bag or bin. That is why there is an increase. But yes, due to this only, we have already given the provision to use the hazardous waste incinerators or other industrial incinerators. For example, some pharmaceutical companies, they have their own incinerators and they run at very high temperature, which because for biomedical waste also, we need the combustion of waste at not below the 850 degrees Celsius, and it at the secondary level combustion, we always ask for more than 1000 degrees Celsius. And those industrial incinerators run usually at 1200 or 1300. So they can dispose, or the biomedical waste can be disposed with the help of those incinerators. And this is the option. And if we segregate the solid waste apart from this biomedical waste, then there is a high chance to get the segregated dry or wet solid waste. So with that, we can go for recycling also. So there are many options available. The only thing is to implement these things, and whatever the guidelines are saying, like with respect to the segregation, especially if the hospitals or the administrators of quarantine camps, if especially because there is a huge mixing of solid waste and yellow waste at the quarantine camps also. Hospitals, they are well aware of the things, they are doing things fine. But these quarantine centers, people sitting over there are still not very much aware of the of all good practices for segregation, and that is why there is a huge increase in overall biomedical waste generation, and they are keeping only yellow color bag or container with them. So they are putting everything in yellow, and that is how the waste, the increase in waste is there. So, but yes, we have given alternate solution for that also to tackle the situation. This is the thing, Dr. Punima.
Yeah, thank you, Yutika, for enlightening us about those alternate options as well. I think those are important pieces of information for us to know. May I now request Dr. Shyamala Mani to talk to us about how to address the issue of dumping of food waste from COVID-19 wards in the yellow bags, and what are the potential questions?
Thank you, Dr. Podima. I want to show a few slides, if I may share. Can you just stop sharing this slide, because then it will be easy for me to explain. Yeah, that's right. So, the solid waste, the biodegradable, what has been suggested even in the solid waste rules is that biomethanation followed by composting is the best method. This is the bulk generator waste for wet waste or the biodegradable waste, even at normal times. So, some of the things which we have found very useful are, one is this, what is known as a closed composter, but actually it has got aeration, it's got a drum, and it's got a screw. So you can actually put the wet waste along with the inoculum and some kind of dry but biodegradable waste. What I mean is like peels of, vegetables and fruits, and even part of garden waste can be put. So, and depending on the capacity and size, these are very useful, because this is taken from the La Meridian Hotel in Delhi. Of course, that comes under the NDMC area. But we are requesting these people to provide this in every hospital, and in whichever places there are some composters also in these large MRFs, which some of the municipal corporations like SDMC and EDMC have deployed, but they are all not being utilized for proper capacity, because everybody is giving mixed waste. But otherwise, we have found that the temperature is going up to almost 70, 75 degrees Celsius. The retention time is, like for a 1-ton composter, the retention time is almost 27 to 28 days, which is adequate to address the problem of COVID waste. And even for a 1/2-ton composter, it is almost there for 21 days. So, except for those instantaneous composters, these are very good. And this give good quality compost, and they also treat the biomedical part of it. And here, this is the left side, you can see this is a biomethanation biphasic. Developed by Professor Sharad Kale from BARC, Bhabha Atomic Research. This is at Tihar Jail. This is also replicable. You can put it up in many places. Here also the retention time, because it's also using aerobic and anaerobic. The retention time is sufficient. The temperature also goes up sufficiently, and because of which the COVID virus can easily be inactivated. And of course, in addition, you get biogas and also, the gas can be, of course, checked. There's no harm that we check the gas, whether there is any residue in that. The same way, the sludge can also be checked. This is another biogas plant, which is a containerized biogas plant. It has a pre-digester and a post-digester. Here also, the retention time and the temperature is sufficient. And here also, this would be very, very effective in killing the COVID virus at the same time. Again, I think I would recommend the testing of the residue of the sludge and the gas. But if all hospitals And several of these large MRFs, they were to use this. This would be a very, very useful way to address the issue. This is, post biomethanation, you can do composting even in pits. Or here you can see that this is a method of mixing the inoculum and grinding it and then doing the composting here. Of course, because it may be COVID-based, you may have to do a little extra by covering it by tarpaulin or something. But with misting and etc., with aeration, here also the temperature goes up adequately. And this is quite adequate to treat the residue from, especially from the biomethanation plants. Here, of course, this is the garden waste. You can see even in the common facilities, the incinerator, like what Yuthika was talking about, incineration plants are being used and the temperature goes up quite high. But unfortunately, what we are seeing is, suppose the barbers or these spas, they are sending their hair or any other waste which is coming. It first comes to these kind of dallows. You can see there it is, this is a SDMC area, not adequate, almost. You see, the person is not wearing boots, no gloves, hardly a kind of a cloth mask. And that also he put it on only after I spoke to him. Mixed waste. And, the community not seeing this issue. So you can see here, this has been sent by one of the participants whom I interacted with this morning. And this is from the Sarita Vihar area. So they have found all this coming from the WTE, waste to energy plant. So this is what I meant, that it may not be adequate to just send these kind of mixed waste to waste to energy plant, because this can create fomites. Some concerns have been sent from Chennai also, and they are asking about the sewerage problems. And what I've noticed is here also, if you use a combination, especially for preventing groundwater pollution, if you use a combination of biomethanation, which has been, the Ministry of Housing and Urban Affairs in its website has given a combination of biomethanation, anaerobic and aerobic digestion, and they have given all these technologies, which they feel are quite adequate to address whether it is maybe having COVID waste through the excreta or ordinary times. So they feel that only thing is we need to test and check whether the sludge and the residual water will have any, the RNA particles. Because in Italy and in some other places, yesterday I was attending one summit and webinar, and they said that some RNA particles have been found. But these are quite effective, and we feel that this may be able to address some of the issues. Even we have found that septic tanks and soak pits, they are also quite adequate, because they are having retention time, the temperature is going up, and it's actually adequate. But we need to test whether the residue, the liquid and the solid, whether it has got any particles and whether there's any transmission from this. Even the eco-san process in very, very remote areas and rural areas, this is also found to be quite effective, because it has temperature and as well as retention time. So we feel that by and large, use of NBS or nature-based solutions would be actually adequate to address both these problems of wet waste and the sewage waste. And this is Devnahalli. There they have actually tested it also. And this is called as an FSTP, fecal sludge treatment plant. Again, anaerobic digestion and aerobic, and use of sunlight and air. And they have said that they have found it very effective, and it is being able to address the issue. Cost is also less. So otherwise, other things are already addressed. So this is the best way, I would say, that COVID-19 can be addressed through use of the nature-based solutions.
Thank you, Dr. Mani, for highlighting some of those very innovative solutions. May I now address this next and last question to the other two panelists, Ms. Yutika Puri and Dr. Ramesh Kumar. This question was also asked by the participants earlier. So this is with regard to waste that is generated from salons and spas and tattoo clinics, which can pose a threat in the COVID-19 scenario. And is this an opportunity to bring these under regulatory purview? So Ms. Yutika?
Yes.
And then I can request Dr. Ramesh Kumar to add on as well.
Yeah, Dr. Punima, yeah. Waste generated from salons and spas and other areas, which you have mentioned here. This is a very, we need to understand the scope of entire biomedical waste management rules also. And, we need to understand what is exactly the biomedical waste, okay? At the general household levels, even though we talk about the disposal of masks and gloves, how to just, give a general guidance to them, like how you can dispose of your used masks and this thing. But if coverage of these salons and spas and tattoos and other piercing clinics, etc. I was wondering while referring this question, like what kind of waste would be there? I mean, from any hair cutting salon, some discarded hair will be there, and
waxing strips. Waxing strips and in shaving places, little drops of blood, cotton, all those things are there, Yutika.
That is okay, ma'am. But if any item which can qualify the definition of biomedical waste, that I can consider as biomedical waste, and in that case, I would really include these areas under the purview of waste management rules. But until unless we are getting general waste in our hands and we are talking about them to include in our regulatory purview, without having any study, this is a very questionable thing that whether we should include them or not. So this is the thing. If somebody or there is a news article, it's okay. Still, we really don't feel that they need to be covered under the purview of this legal framework. If we can do some kind of study or some kind of survey from these centers, then maybe we would be in a picture to say more on this topic. But as of now, I don't think that we should say yes to inclusion of these areas into the regulatory purview. Yes.
I think I was muted. So I thank you, Ms. Yutika, for sharing your thoughts on this. May I request Dr. Kumar, because I think this is still a gray area and we all have some doubts on our minds about this. So Dr. Kumar, what are your thoughts on this?
No doubt it is a basically gray area, but every municipality has a rule regulation to register this type of business under their act. As far as act is concerned, municipal act is concerned, the business related to, I am audible?
Yes, sir. Yes, you are.
Trade business related to beauty therapy, applying cosmetics, hairdressing, tattooing. In fact, tattooing is very important, and skin piercing is also very important because you are penetrating their skin, and which can be a health hazard as far as their health is concerned. And these are your type to require the health license. In the health license, what the municipality sees about whether they keep business clean, whether they are using sterile equipment, whether they are having their hand facilities in their premises, whether they are using separate seat separate seat for individual person. And in fact, then I think I am reading somewhere there is some age limit also. Under 18, you cannot do for tattooing also. And then there is also some guideline for any saloon. They keep the instruments right after every shaving or after every hair cutting. They have to keep some separate tub for this.
Yeah.
Dr. Punim, I would like to add one more point here. Like, am I audible?
Yes, you are. Yeah.
Yeah. If we are talking about for inclusion of such places into this legal framework, then we should, we should think about our other part also, other like for our treatment facility operators and the existing infrastructure we have for the final disposal of waste coming out of it. In Delhi, we don't have even secured landfill with us to dispose the hazardous waste and all. So, this kind of things should also be considered while finalizing such big thing. I'll definitely, if somebody or through your organization also, if there is any proposal, you may anytime submit it to the concerned ministry or concerned department. But still, there is a need to elaborate more on this aspect and with the proper study only we can finalize such big decision on this.
Thank you. So I think I'll hand over now to Ananya. Thank you to all the panelists for having addressed all these concerns. I know there are still some unaddressed kind of areas. There are lots of questions that we can
see. Can I answer those questions, yeah. Actually, regarding the parlors and the tattoo clinics? Actually, the waste generated from such centers should not be considered as biomedical waste, because in that context, we have lot many things which will be considered as biomedical waste. See, pandemic is there and the government is testing. So unless proved otherwise, don't consider these as biomedical waste generators, because when these rules were being framed, me and Dr. Shyamala Mani were there at that time in Ministry of Environment. The question had come at that time also, but these should not be coming under the ambit of the rules, the parlors or, these are basically, you can say, bulk waste generators, maximum.
Exactly, yeah.
Yes, you can say hazardous waste bin with that, along with the green or the blue waste bin, they can keep a hazardous waste bin for disposal of PPs. That's it.
Domestic hazardous waste, you mean? Yes. Domestic?
Yes.
Exactly, and then domestic hazardous waste can be channelized through the municipalities to their defined the treatment centers.
But it goes to common biomedical waste only.
Yeah, it will go to the common biomedical waste only, ma'am. But it should it should qualify the definition of domestic hazardous waste. We have given items in solid waste and biomedical waste management rules both. What is domestic hazardous waste? So wax strips and discarded hairs and etc. These things are really and not yet covered under the. Those definitions. So
yeah, because I would like to bring to the knowledge that the airports now they are giving these PPEs, especially the face shields and masks, to their passengers. So they have started keeping the domestic hazardous yellow bins. You can check with the Delhi airport also and other airports also, along with the blue and green bins, in context of this pandemic.
Yes, and we have another example to share. Like for example, for the disposal of used sanitary pads, this particular point is not covered under, like it is, the disposal option is given under solid waste management rules, and which says like it should be just small precautions, separate storage and separate handing over the things to the municipality workers. So this is just like that. I mean, if we really want to give separate or extra precautions to these centers, then we can give some guidance to them Otherwise, simply giving the entire waste coming out of these places to the common facility operators for the disposal along with the biomedical waste would not be the justice for the waste management rules also, because these rules talks about segregation and identification of biomedical waste, entire categorization is given in the rules, so that is also one of the concern.
Thank you so much, all of the panelists, for sharing all your knowledge on this important area of waste management. I think we could have gone on for another hour, it looks like, because there's so many questions that are there. But I will turn it over to Ananya to kind of summarize and decide how we would like to pass on the questions to the panelists later.
Thank you, Dr. Poonima. These were very good and enriching discussions that we had, very comprehensive. We basically covered everything right from the importance of PPE and disposal, the right method of disposing the PPE, as well as how to dispose each and every waste category and several other issues which were not directly associated with biomedical waste. So we are a little behind time. So I also see that many of the questions have been answered by the panel members. And some of them have already been discussed during this panel discussion. So I would request everyone to please note. For any more queries, if you have, and you would like to now basically, this is my ID, and you can write to me for any more queries, the queries that have been left out. We will definitely write back to you. We will share the responses from our individual panel members. And with this, I would like to end this webinar. But before this, I would like to thank our panel members for their kind participation and our audience for having participating in the active discussion. I would like to thank Dr. Poonima Prabhakaran for her kind guidance during organizing this webinar throughout. I'm extremely grateful to our team members, Dr. Mani, Mr. Sriram Manoharan, Mr. Subi Dogra, and Mansoor Azam for helping us and supporting us throughout in putting this event together. Thank you, everyone, and have a great evening.
Thank you, Dr. Poonima, and thank you, Ananya, and thank you, rest of the panelists, and thanks the audience for the interactive sessions, and be safe, all the COVID warriors. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Dr. Malini, Dr. Ramesh Kumar, Yutika, Dr. Poonima, and Ananya. Thank you very much. And all the PHFI members.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much.
Okay, bye.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
Thank you all for joining us. Thank you.
Bye. Thank you, ma'am.